Hi, my name's T.S. Garp.
The World According to Garp was made by director George Roy Hill in 1982 from the novel by John Irving. It was fairly successful, both critically and commercially, and it's attracted a bit of a following over the years. It has charm, but it also has some structural and conceptual problems that I don't think it ever really resolves.
Don't touch me! Don't touch me! Don't touch me!
But I wasn't asked about that when I was approached for this commentary. I was asked to comment on the character of Roberta Muldoon. Roberta is a transsexual, and being a transsexual myself, I have a certain vested interest in her.
Boy, she got problems.
Yes, she does.
I mean, it's whatever problems I may have with the film itself, I confess that I love Roberta Muldoon. She is one of my favorite characters. She's a very rare thing among depictions of transgenderism. She's not a victim, and she's not a prostitute, and she's not a punchline, and she's not a psychopath, which are the most common depictions of transsexuals. There were a goodly number of transsexual characters in films prior to The World According to Garp, mostly in fringe cinema like Beyond the Valley of the Dolls and Myra Breckinridge and some of the Warhol films. But none of them were particularly positive portrayals. So the depiction of Roberta Muldoon was not just a fairly rare thing in 1982, it remains so today, 26 years later, which kind of depresses me, actually. But to put this into some kind of perspective, I watched four recent films in the last 12 months in which the lead character was a transsexual. In all four of these films, the character was a prostitute. So thank God for John Irving and John Lithgow, because their Roberta is a character who actually rings true as a human being rather than as a stereotype.
Now, the thing that's really hard is that I'd love to have kids. Of course I can't.
I think the humanity of Roberta Muldoon begins with John Lithgow, who has said that he took the role as a kind of apologia for his performance in Brian De Palma's Blowout, in which he played a character who murders women indiscriminately as part of the conspiracy cover-up. I don't know that Lithgow thought the movie itself was misogynist. He worked with De Palma again in Raising Cain, after all. But he thought his character almost certainly was, hence his desire to make amends with Roberta. Unspoken in this motivation is the notion that Lithgow saw Roberta as a woman, which is something that eludes many depictions of transsexuals, which view them as something other. In the context of the film, I think Roberta is the most centered and wise character.
I know. Everyone here has something missing, or some wound that won't heal, and your mother tries to nurse them back to health. She's a wonderful person.
Are you visiting somebody here?
No, why?
Well, you just seem like the only normal person around the place.
Oh, I don't know.
I think it's telling that T.S. Garp himself identifies her almost immediately as being the least screwed up person surrounding his mother. She is almost certainly the character in the film that shows the least amount of damage, though this is a relative thing, given how damaged everyone around her actually is. But more than that, I think they got a lot of the details right. She's not particularly pretty. She is still burdened with the height and bone structure of a male, which is common among many transsexuals. I know a number of transsexuals who find living with their height very difficult. Roberta, at least, seems to have negotiated a truce with it, but she's not above using her size to her advantage, which is not an uncommon reaction.
Listen, goddammit, if you don't get Laurel's ass out here, I'm gonna clean it!
Oh. I hate to use a corny line like this, but haven't I seen you before?
You like football?
Oh, yeah, I used to watch it quite a bit.
Well, you might have seen me. I was a tight end with the Philadelphia Eagles.
I don't think the conceit of Roberta's past profession as a professional football player is that outlandish either, even though I'm sure it was conceived for its comedic value. Male-to-female transsexuals often pursue very manly professions prior to transition. And since I've actually met a real ex-football player in real life who was transsexual, it doesn't ring false to me in the least. I also like the scene after Garp and Roberta are chased when she starts crying as a hormonal response.
It's just one of those raging hormonal attacks.
This is very much on the money. Hormonal therapy does create very wild emotional swings. But finally, Roberta gets the movie's best line.
Well, at least he's better off than... What was his name?
Michael Milton.
Yes. Milton. I mean, I had mine removed surgically under general anesthesia, but to have it
bitten off. It's a nightmare.
It's lust.
I think actors probably live for that sort of thing. John Lithgow was nominated for an Academy Award for his performance in this movie, and I think he very much deserved it. That was a very weird year at the Oscars, because in addition to Lithgow, Dustin Hoffman was nominated for Tootsie, and Julie Andrews was nominated for playing a woman playing a man playing a woman in Victor Victoria. I think it's interesting to contrast those three performances, because Hoffman's Tootsie is a pretty standard gender-bending farce, along the lines of Some Like It Hot. It doesn't really have much to say about gender politics, per se. While the gender politics in Victor Victoria are at least 40 years older than the movie itself, because it's a remake of a German film from the Weimar period, which has been remade several times in the period between the original and the Blake Edwards movie. Both Hoffman and Julie Andrews eventually play their characters for laughs. This is fairly common in depictions of transsexuals and the transgendered in general. Lithgow's performance is considerably more nuanced and considerably more true.
Maybe so. I'm a hopeless romantic in a male chauvinist world. Bye, darlings!